Fundamental Education. Samael Aun Weor. One Fundamental Education by Samael Aun Weor. Fundamental Education. Samael Aun Weor. Two Chapter 1 Free Initiative. Millions of students throughout the world go to school and university daily in an unconscious, mechanical and subjective way, without knowing why or for what purpose. Students are forced to study mathematics, physics, chemistry, geography, etc. Students' minds are receiving information daily, however, in life it never occurs to them to think for a while the reason of such information and its objective. Why and for what purpose do we feed ourselves with that information? Students really live a mechanical life and only know that they have to receive intellectual information and store it in their unfaithful memory, that is all. It never occurs to students to think about what education really is. They go to school, college and university, because their parents say so. It never occurs to students or teachers to ask themselves, why am I here? What have I come here for? What really is the true secret motivation which brings me here? Teachers and students live with their conscience asleep. They really act as machines, going to school, college, university, in an unconscious and subjective way, without really knowing why or for what reason. It is necessary to stop being machines, to awaken conscience and discover for ourselves, what does it mean this utterly terrifying struggle of passing exams, living at a certain place to study daily and spend the whole year going through worries, anguishes and painful moments, practicing sports, going through arguments, fighting with fellow students, etc. Teachers should become more conscious, in order to help students to awaken their conscience, be it at school, college or university. It is regrettable to see so many machines seated at desks, in schools, colleges and universities, receiving information that they have to memorize, without knowing why or for what purpose. Young people are only worried about getting through and finishing the school year. They have been told they should prepare themselves to earn a living, get a job, etc. They study building up a thousand fantasies about the future without really knowing the present moment, without knowing the true reason for studying physics, chemistry, biology, arithmetic, geography, etc. Modern girls study to prepare themselves, to find a good husband, to earn a living, and be duly prepared in case they are abandoned, widowed or never marry. Pure fantasies of the mind, because, in fact, they do not know what the future holds for them, nor at what age will they die. Fundamental Education. Samael Aun Weor. 3. Life at school is very vague, incoherent and subjective. Children are forced to learn certain subjects, which are worthless in everyday life. Nowadays, what is important at school is getting through the year's course and that is all. In the past, there was at least something ethical in passing a year's course. Now, such ethics do not exist. Parents can secretly bribe teachers. Even if a boy or girl is an extremely bad student, he/she will inevitably pass the year. Schoolgirls often sweeten male teachers with the purpose of passing the school year, and the result is usually marvelous, even when they have not understood anything about what was taught by the teacher. By all means, they do well in their examinations and pass the school year. There are students who are very clever at passing a school year. This is a matter of tricks and astuteness in many cases. For a student who successfully passes a certain examination, some stupid examination, it does not mean that he has a true objective conscience about the subject in which he was examined. A student repeats in a mechanical way, like a parrot, the subject he studied and which he was examined in. That does not mean we are conscious of that subject, but that means to memorize and repeat like a parrot or chatterbox what we have learned, and that is all. To pass an examination and get through a year does not mean we are very intelligent. In everyday life we have known very intelligent people who never did well in examinations at school. We have known magnificent writers and great mathematicians who were very bad students at school and never did well in grammar and mathematics examinations. We know a case of a very bad student in anatomy who was only able to do well in anatomy examinations after much suffering. Today, that student is the author of a popular book on anatomy. To pass a school year does not necessarily mean we are very intelligent. There are people who have never passed the school year and they are very intelligent. There is something more important than passing a school year and studying certain subjects, that is precisely to have full objective conscience, clear and luminous, about those subjects being studied. Fundamental education Samael Aun Weor for teachers should exert themselves to help students to awaken their conscience. They should direct all their efforts to the conscience of students. It is imperative for students to have a full conscience about the subjects they study. To learn by heart, like parrots, is simply stupid in the most complete sense of the word. Students are forced to study difficult subjects and to store them in their memory to pass a school year. Afterwards, in everyday life, these subjects are not only useless, but are also forgotten because the memory is unfaithful. Young people study with the purpose of obtaining a job and earning their living. Later, if they are lucky, they get their desired job. If they become professionals, doctors, lawyers, etc., they will only repeat the same story as always: they marry, have children and suffer. They die without awakening conscience, without having conscience of their own life. Girls marry, have their homes, children, argue with their neighbors, husband and children, divorce, remarry, become widows, grow old, etc. In the end, they die after having lived asleep, unconscious, repeating the same painful drama of existence as usual. Teachers do not want to accept the fact that all human beings have their conscience asleep. It is imperative for teachers to awaken their conscience, so that they can help to awaken the student's conscience. It is useless to fill our heads with more and more theories and to quote Dante, Homer, Virgil, etc., if our conscience is sleeping, if we do not have a clear and objective conscience about ourselves, the subjects we study and everyday life. What is the use of education, if we do not become creative, conscious and truly intelligent? Real education does not mean knowing how to read and write. Any stupid person, any fool can know how to read and write. We need to have intelligence, and it only awakens within us when the conscience awakens. Mankind has 97% of subconsciousness and 3% of conscience. We need to awaken conscience in order to turn the subconscious into conscious and achieve 100% of conscience. A human being not only dreams when his physical body sleeps, but also dreams when his physical body does not sleep, when he is in a state of wakefulness. Fundamental education Samael Aun Weor 5. It is necessary to stop dreaming, to awaken conscience, and that awakening process should begin at home and school. Teachers' efforts should be directed to students' conscience and not just to the memory. Students should learn to think for themselves, and not only repeat others' theories like parrots or chatterboxes. Teachers should struggle to put an end to fear in students. Teachers should allow their students freedom to disagree and healthily criticize, in a constructive manner, all theories that are studied. It is absurd to force them to accept in a dogmatic way all the theories taught in school, college and university. It is necessary and imperative for students to abandon fear, to be able to think for themselves and analyze theories which they study. Fear is one of the barriers to intelligence. Students with fear do not dare to disagree and blindly accept as articles of faith whatever different authors say. It is useless for teachers to talk about fearlessness if they are fearful. Teachers should be free of fear. Teachers who fear criticism, what people say, etc., cannot be truly intelligent. The true objective of education should be to awaken conscience and put an end to fear. What is the use of passing examinations if we continue being afraid and unconscious? Teachers have the duty to help students at their school desks to become useful in life, but as long as fear exists, no one can be useful in life. A person full of fear does not dare to disagree with other people's opinion. A person full of fear cannot have free initiative. Clearly, every teacher's duty is to help each of his students in school to become completely free of fear, so that they can act spontaneously without the need to be told or ordered. Fundamental education Samael Aun Weor 6. When students, by their own free and spontaneous initiative, can freely analyze and criticize the theories they study, they will stop being mere subjective and stupid, mechanical entities. It is imperative for free initiative to exist so that the student's creative intelligence emerges. It is necessary to give the students the freedom of spontaneous creative expression, without any type of conditioning, so that they become conscious of what they study. Free creative power can only manifest itself when we do not fear criticism, what people say, teachers' authority, rules, etc. The human mind is degenerated by fear and dogmatism, and it is imperative to regenerate it through spontaneous free initiative, devoid of fear. We need to become conscious of our own life, and that process of awakening should begin at school desks. School will be of very little use to us if we leave it in an unconscious and asleep state. Free initiative and the removal of fear will give rise to spontaneous and pure action. Through free initiative, students in every school should have the right to discuss in assembly all the theories they are studying. Only in this way, through liberation from fear and freedom of discussion, analysis, meditation and health criticism of what we study, can we become conscious of subjects and not be merely like parrots or chatterboxes that repeat what they accumulate in their memory. Fundamental Education, Samael Aun Weor 7, Chapter 2, Imitation. It has already been totally demonstrated that fear stops free initiative. The bad financial situation of millions of people is, beyond any doubt, due to fear. A fearful boy seeks his dear mother and becomes attached to her in search for security. A fearful husband becomes attached to his wife and feels that he loves her even more. A frightened wife feels attached to her husband and children and thinks she loves them much more. From the physiological point of view, it is strange and interesting to see how fear often disguises itself in love's chothings. People who have very little spiritual values within, who are internally poor, always seek something external to make themselves complete. Internally poor people are always worried about foolishness, gossip, bestial pleasures, etc. Internally poor people live from fear to fear and, as it is natural, become attached to their husband, wife, parents, children, to old and degenerated traditions, etc. Every sick and poor physiologically old man is usually full of fear and clings with infinite anxiety to money, family traditions, grandchildren, memories, etc., as if seeking security. This is something we can all see by carefully observing old people. Whenever people are afraid, they hide behind the protective shield of respectability by following a tradition of race, family or nation, etc. Actually, every tradition is merely a senseless repetition, empty and without true value. All people have a marked tendency to imitate others, and this imitating is a product of fear. People with fear imitate all those to whom they become attached. They imitate husbands, wives, children, brothers, friends who protect them, etc. Imitation is the result of fear and totally destroys free initiative. In schools, colleges and universities, teachers make the mistake of teaching through imitation. Fundamental Education, Samael Aun Weor 8. In painting and drawing lessons, students are taught to copy images of trees, houses, mountains, animals, etc. That is not creating, that is imitating, taking a picture. Creating is not imitating or taking a picture. To create is to translate and vividly transmit with a brush, a tree that enchants us, a beautiful sunset, a dawn with its ineffable melodies, etc. There is true creation in Chinese and Japanese Zen art, both abstract and semi-abstract. Any Chinese painter of Chan and Zen is not interested in imitating, taking pictures. Painters of China and Japan enjoy creating again and again. Painters of Zen and Chan do not imitate, they create, and this is their work. Painters of China and Japan are not interested in painting or taking a picture of a beautiful woman. They enjoy transmitting her abstract beauty. Painters of China and Japan would never imitate a sunset. They enjoy transmitting in abstract beauty all the enchantment of sunset. What is important is not to imitate, to copy in black or white. What is important is to feel the deep meaning of beauty and know how to transmit it, but for that, it is necessary not to have fear, attachment to rules, traditions, fear of what people might say, or fear of the teacher's reprimand. It is imperative that teachers understand the necessity for students to develop creative power. It is clearly absurd to teach students to imitate. It is better to teach them to create. Unfortunately, human beings are unconscious, sleeping machines, who only know how to imitate. We imitate other people's clothes, and out of that imitation emerge the different trends of fashion. We imitate other people's customs even when they are mistaken. We imitate vices, we imitate all, that which is absurd and that which is always repeated throughout time, etc. It is necessary for teachers to teach their students how to think independently. Fundamental Education Samael Aun Weor 9 teachers should give their students all possibilities, in order that they stop being mechanical imitators. Teachers should provide the best opportunities available for students to develop creative power. It is imperative for students to know true freedom, so that they learn to think independently and without fear at all. A mind, which lives enslaved to what people may say, a mind which imitates, because of fear of violating traditions, rules, customs, etc., is not a creative mind, neither a free mind. People's mind is like a house, closed and sealed with 7 seals. A house, where nothing new can happen, where the sun does not shine, where only death and pain reigns. The new can only take place when fear does not exist, when both imitation and attachment to things, money, people, traditions, customs, etc., do not exist. People live enslaved to plotting, envy, family customs, habits, the insatiable desire to conquer positions, climb to the top, make themselves felt, etc. It is imperative for teachers to teach their students the necessity of not imitating this degenerate and out-of-date order of time-worn things. It is imperative that students learn to create, think and feel freely in school. Students spend the best part of their lives at school acquiring information, and yet they do not have time left to think about all these things. 10 or 15 years at school living a mechanical and unconscious life, they leave school with their conscience asleep, yet believing themselves to be awake. The human mind lives bottled up between conservative and reactionary ideas. Human beings cannot think with true freedom, because they are full of fear. Human beings fear life, death, what people say or might say, they fear gossip, losing their jobs, breaking regulations or someone taking away their partners, etc. At school we are taught to imitate, and we leave school after having been transformed into imitators. We do not have free initiative, because from our school desks, we were taught to imitate. Fundamental Education Samael Aun Weor 10 people imitate because of fear of what other people might say. Students imitate because teachers terrorize them, they threaten them with low marks, specific punishments and expulsion, etc. If we really want to become creative in the most complete sense of the word, we should become conscious of all those imitations which unfortunately have us trapped. When we are already capable of knowing all those imitations, and have very closely analyzed each of them, we become conscious of them, and as a logical consequence, the power to create is spontaneously born within us. It is necessary for students at school, colleges and universities to free themselves from all imitation so that they become truly creative. Teachers who erroneously assume that students need to imitate in order to learn, are mistaken. Whoever imitates does not learn, but becomes a machine and that is all. It is not a case of imitation what authors of geography, physics, arithmetic, history, etc., say. To imitate, memorize, repeat like chatterboxes or parrots is stupid. It is better to consciously understand what we are studying. Fundamental education is the science of the conscience, which allows us to discover our relationship with human beings, nature and everything. A mind which only knows how to imitate is mechanical, is a machine which functions, incapable of creating, it does not truly think, and only repeats, that is all. Teachers should be concerned about the awakening of conscience in each student. Students only worry about passing the school year and later, once out of school in practical life, they become ordinary office clerks or child-making machines. 10 or 15 years of study so as to come out transformed into talking machines. The subjects studied are forgotten little by little until at last, nothing remains in the memory. If students become conscious of the subjects they studied, if their studies were not only based on information, imitation and memory, matters would be different. They would leave school having acquired conscious, unforgettable and complete knowledge, which would not be subjected to their unfaithful memories. Fundamental education will help students by awakening their conscience and intelligence. Fundamental education takes young people along the path of true revolution. Fundamental education Samael Aun Weor 11 students would insist the teachers give them true education, fundamental education. It is not enough for students to sit at school desks, to receive information about a king or a war, but something else is needed. Fundamental education is needed to awaken conscience. It is imperative for students to leave school mature, truly conscious and intelligent, so that they do not become simple automatic parts of social machinery. Fundamental Education Samael Aun Weor 12 Chapter 3 The Authorities. The government has authority. The state has authority. The police, the law, soldiers, parents, teachers, religious leaders, etc., have authority. There are two types of authority, subconscious and conscious. Unconscious and subconscious authorities are useless. We imperatively need authorities with conscience. Unconscious authorities have filled the world with tears and pain. Unconscious authorities abuse authority at home and at school, precisely because they are unconscious. Today, unconscious parents and teachers are only blind leaders of the blind, and as the sacred scriptures say, they will all end up head first in the abyss. Unconscious parents and teachers force us to do absurd things, which they consider logical during infancy. They say it is for our own good. Parents are unconscious authorities, as it is demonstrated by their treatment of children as trash, as if parents were the superior species of mankind. Teachers end up hating certain students, and pampering or spoiling others. They sometimes severely punish any hated student, even if he and she is studious, and reward with magnificent grades students, who are spoiled and do not really deserve it. Parents and teachers dictate erred norms to children and young people. Authorities who do not possess conscience can only do absurd things. We need authorities who have conscience. By this we mean that they should have integral knowledge of themselves, total knowledge of all their inner values. Only he who truly possesses complete knowledge of him is awake in an integral form and has conscience. Everyone believes they know themselves, but it is very difficult to find someone in life who truly knows himself. People have totally mistaken concepts about themselves. To know oneself requires great and awesome personal efforts. Only through the knowledge of oneself do we truly achieve conscience. Fundamental Education Samael Aun Weor 13 The abuse of authority is due to unconsciousness. No authority with conscience would ever abuse authority. Some philosophers are against all authority, they detest authorities. Such a way of thinking is false because within everything created, from a microbe to a sun, there are levels and levels, degrees and degrees, superior forces that control and direct and inferior forces, which are controlled and directed. In a simple beehive, the authority lies with the queen. In any ant's nest there exist authority and laws. The destruction of the authority principle would lead to anarchy. The authorities of these critical times in which we live are unconscionable, and it is obvious that due to this physiological fact, they enslave, shackle, abuse, and cause pain. We need masters, instructors or spiritual guides, government authorities, parents, etc., who have full conscience. Only in this manner can we truly create a better world. It is stupid to say that spiritual masters and spiritual guides are not needed. It is absurd to be unaware of the authority principle in all creation. Those who are self-sufficient and proud have the opinion that masters and spiritual guides are not necessary. We should recognize our own nothingness and misery. We should understand that we need authorities, masters, spiritual instructors, etc., but with conscience so that they can guide and help us wisely. The unconscious authority of teachers destroys the creative power of students. If a student paints, the unconscious teacher tells him what he should paint, which tree or scenery he should copy. Fearful students do not dare spit outside the mechanical rules of teachers. That is not creating. It is necessary for a student to become creative, to be capable of stepping out of the unconscious norms of unconscious teachers, so that he or she is able to transmit all that he feels in relation to all the enchantment and deep meaning of life, which circulates on a tree's trembling leaves. Teachers with conscience would not oppose free creativity of the heart. Teachers with conscious authority would never mutilate the minds of students. Unconscious teachers destroy the mind and intelligence of students. Fundamental education. Samael Aun Weor. 14. Teachers with unconscious authority only know how to punish and dictate stupid rules so that students may behave well. Teachers with conscience teach their students with extreme patience, helping them to understand their individual difficulties, so that by understanding they are able to transcend all their errors and advance successfully. Authority with conscience would never destroy intelligence. Unconscious authority destroys intelligence and causes serious damages to students. Intelligence only comes to us when we enjoy authentic freedom. Teachers with conscious authority truly know how to respect creative freedom. Unconscious teachers believe that they know it all and ruin students' freedom by castrating their intelligence with lifeless norms. Teachers with conscience know that they do not know, and even give themselves the luxury of learning by observing the creative capacity of their students. It is necessary for school, college and university students to go from the simple condition of disciplined machines to the brilliant position of intelligent free being, so that they are able to face all the problems of existence with success. This requires competent teachers with conscience, who really become interested in their students. Well-paid teachers so that they may never have monetary problems of any type. Unfortunately, every teacher, parent and student believes to have conscience and to be awake, but that is their gravest error. In life it is very rare to find an awakened person with conscience. People dream when their body sleeps and dream when their body is awake. People drive cars dreaming, they work dreaming, walk in the streets dreaming, live all the time dreaming. It is very natural for a professor to forget his umbrella, a book or wall in his car. All that happens because the professor has his conscience asleep, he dreams. It is very difficult for people to accept that they are asleep. The entire world believes that it is awake. If someone was to accept that his conscience is asleep, it is obvious that he would begin to awaken from that very moment. Fundamental education. Samael Aun Weor. 15. A student leaves his book or a notebook at home, which he has to carry to school. Forgetfulness of this type seems very normal, but it indicates the state of sleep in which the human conscience is. The passengers of any urban transport service often miss the street where they should have got off. They were asleep, and when they awake they realize they have missed their street and have to walk back a few blocks. A human being is rarely really awake in life, and when he does awake for a brief moment, as in cases of infinite terror, he momentarily sees himself in an integral form. These moments are unforgettable. It is very difficult for a person who returns home, after having traveled through an entire city, to remember in detail all his thoughts, incidents, people, things, ideas, etc. On trying to remember, the person will find huge gaps in his memory, which correspond precisely to the most profound states of sleep. Some students of psychology have set out to live on alert from moment to moment, but suddenly fall asleep, perhaps on meeting a friend in the street, on entering a store to buy something, etc., and hours later, when they remember their decision to live on alert and awake from instant to instant, they realize they had fallen asleep when they entered such and such a place, or met such and such a person. Conscience is something very difficult to achieve, but one can reach this state by learning to live on alert and vigilance from moment to moment. If we want to achieve conscience, we need to know ourselves in an integral form. Every one of us has the ego, the self, which we need to explore to know ourselves in order to achieve conscience. It is imperative to observe ourselves, analyze and understand each of our defects. It is necessary to study ourselves in the field of the mind, emotions, habits, instincts and sex. The mind has many subconscious levels, regions or departments that we should know through observation, analysis, in-depth meditation and profound understanding. Any defect can disappear from the intellectual region and continue existing in other unconscious levels of the mind. The first thing needed is to awaken, in order to understand our own misery, nothingness and pain. Afterwards, the ego begins to die from moment to moment. The death of the physiological ego is imperative. Fundamental education. Samael Aun Weor. 16. Only by dying, a truly conscious being is born within us. Only our being can exercise true conscious authority. Awakening, death and birth are the three physiological phases that lead us to true conscious existence. We must be awakening in order to die, and must die in order to be born. Whoever dies without having awakened becomes a stupid saint. Whoever is born without having died becomes an individual with a double personality, the very just and the very perverse. The exercise of true authority can only be exercised by those who possess conscious being. Those who do not yet possess conscious being, and have got no conscience, tend to abuse authority and cause great harm. Teachers should learn to rule and students should learn to obey. Those psychologists who pronounce themselves against obedience are in fact very mistaken, because no one can rule consciously if he has not first learned to obey. It is necessary to know how to rule consciously and to obey consciously. Fundamental Education, Samael Aun Weor, 17, Chapter 4. Discipline. Teachers of schools, colleges and universities give too much importance to discipline, and we should study this matter in detail in this chapter. All of us who have gone through school, college or university know very well what is discipline, rules, frules, scoldings, etc. Discipline is that which is called the cultivation of resistance. School teachers delight in cultivating resistance. Resistance is taught to us to build something against some other thing. We are taught to resist the temptations that laziness brings, temptations of not studying, of not going to school, of playing, laughing, ridiculing teachers, violating rules, etc. Teachers have the mistaken concept that through discipline we can understand the need for respecting school rules, for studying, maintaining our composure before teachers, behaving well with our classmates, etc. There exists among people the mistaken concept that the more we resist, the more we reject, then the more we make ourselves understandable, free, complete, successful. People do not want to realize that the more we fight against something, the more we resist, the more we reject, the less is our comprehension. If we fight against the vice of drinking, this vice will disappear for a while, but since we have not understood it profoundly in all the levels of the mind, it will return later, when we neglect our vigilance, and we will drink at once for a whole year. If we reject the vice of fornication, we will be chaste in appearance for a while, even though in other levels of the mind we will continue being frightening stirs, as our erotic dreams and our wet dreams demonstrate. Then we will return with more strength to our old ways of unredeemable fornicators, due to the concrete fact of not having profoundly understood what fornications is. Many are those who reject greed, who fight against it, discipline themselves against it following strict norms of conduct, but since they have not truly understood the whole process of greed, it turns out they covet deep down the state of not being greedy. Many are those who discipline themselves against anger, who learn to resist it, but the former continues existing in other levels of the subconscious mind, even when it has apparently disappeared in our character and at the slightest neglect of our fundamental education. Samael Aun Weor, 18. Guard, the subconscious betrays us, and then we thunder and flash filled with anger, when we least expect it and perhaps for some unimportant reason. Many are those who discipline themselves against jealousy, and finally firmly believe that they have extinguished it, but since they did not understand it, clearly it appears once more in a scene precisely when we thought it was truly dead. Only in the full absence of disciplines, only in real freedom, will the burning flame of understanding emerge in the mind. Creative freedom can never exist in a framework. We need freedom to fully understand our physiological defects. We urgently need to demolish walls and break steel shackles to be free. We have to experience for ourselves everything that our school teachers and parents have told us as good and useful. It is not enough to memorize and imitate. We need to understand. All teachers' efforts should be directed to the conscience of students. They should exert themselves so that students enter the path of understanding. It is not enough to tell students that they should be this or that. It is necessary that students learn to be free so that they can examine, study, analyze for themselves all the values, all the things that people have told them are beneficial, useful, noble, and not just accept them and imitate them. People do not want to explore for themselves. They have closed, stupid minds that do not want to investigate. mechanical minds that never investigate and only imitate. It is necessary, urgent, indispensable for students to enjoy true freedom, to discover themselves, to inquire, to understand from their earliest years until the moment they leave the classroom, and not to be limited by the object walls of prohibitions, scoldings, and disciplines. If students are told what they should and should not do, and they are not allowed to understand and experience, where then is their intelligence? What opportunity has been given to their intelligence? Then, what is the use of passing exams, dress up smartly and have many friends, if we are not intelligent? Intelligence only comes to us when we are truly free to investigate for ourselves, to understand, to analyze independently without the fear of scoldings and without the fear of disciplines. Scared, frightened students submitted to terrible disciplines can never know. They can never be intelligent. Fundamental Education, Samael Aun Weor, 19. Today the only thing that interests parents and teachers is that students have a career, that they become doctors, lawyers, engineers, office employees, living machines, and that they later marry, and also transform themselves into child-making machines, and that is all. When boys or girls want to do something new, something different, when they feel the need to escape from this framework of prejudices, antiquated habits, disciplines, family or national traditions, etc., then the parents tighten the shackles of prison more and they tell the boy or girl, "Do not do that. We are not willing to support you in that. These things are madness," etc. Thus the boy or girl is formally imprisoned inside the prison of disciplines, traditions, antiquated customs, decrepit ideas, etc. Fundamental Education teaches the conciliation of order with freedom. Order without freedom is tyranny. Freedom without order is anarchy. Freedom and order wisely combined constitute the basis of Fundamental Education. Students should enjoy perfect freedom to find out for themselves, to inquire, to discover what they really and truly are in themselves and what they can do in life. Students, soldiers, police, and in general all those people who have to live subjected to rigorous disciplines, usually become cruel and insensitive to human pain, merciless. Discipline destroys human sensitivity, and that has already been totally demonstrated by observation and experience. Due to so many disciplines and rules, people of this age have totally lost all sensitivity and have become cruel and merciless. In order to be truly free, one needs to be sensitive and humane. In schools, colleges and universities, students are taught to pay attention in classes, and the students pay attention to avoid a scolding, a pulling of ears, a beating with the ruler, etc., but unfortunately, they are not taught to really understand what conscious attention is. Out of discipline, the student pays attention and many times wastes creative energy in a useless way. The creative energy is the most subtle type of energy fabricated by the human machine. Fundamental Education, Samael Aun Weor, 20. Eating, drinking, and all the processes of digestion are, deep down, transformation processes in which gross substances become useful substances and energies. The creative energy is the most subtle type of matter and energy made by the organism. If we know how to consciously pay attention, we can save creative energy. Unfortunately, teachers do not teach their students what conscious attention is. Wherever we direct our attention, we spend creative energy. We can save that energy if we divide attention, if we do not become identified with things, people and ideas. When we identify ourselves with things, people and ideas, we forget ourselves and lose creative energy in the most pitiful way. It is imperative to know that we need to save creative energy, to awaken conscience, and that creative energy is living potential. It is the vehicle of the conscience, an instrument to awaken conscience. When we learn not to forget ourselves, when we learn to divide the attention between subject, object and place, we save creative energy to awaken conscience. It is necessary to learn to use attention to awaken conscience, but students do not know anything about this, because their teachers have not taught them. When we learn to use attention consciously, discipline becomes unnecessary. A student who pays attention in the class, to his lessons and to order, does not need discipline of any type. It is imperative that teachers understand the need for intelligently reconciling freedom and order, and this is possible through conscious attention. Conscious attention excludes that which is called identification. When we identify ourselves with things, people, and ideas, fascination takes over, producing the sleep of the conscience. We must know how to pay attention without identification. When we pay attention to something or someone and we forget ourselves, it results in fascination and the sleep of the conscience. Observe carefully a moviegoer. He is asleep, unaware of everything and of himself. He is empty within and looks like a zombie. He dreams with the movie and the hero he is watching. Fundamental education. Samael Aun Weor. 21. Students should pay attention in classrooms without forgetting themselves, so that they do not fall into the terrible sleep of the conscience. A student should see himself in action, when he is taking an exam or when he is at the blackboard, as told by the teacher, or when he is studying or resting or playing with his classmates. Attention divided in the parts, subject, object, place, is in fact, conscious attention. When we do not commit the error of identifying ourselves with things, people and ideas, we save creative energy and we accelerate within us the awakening of conscience. Whoever wants to awaken conscience in the superior worlds should begin by awakening in the here and now. When a student commits the error of identifying himself with things, people, and ideas, he commits the error of forgetting himself and falls asleep through fascination. Discipline does not teach students to pay attention. Discipline is a true prison for the mind. Students should learn to use conscious attention from the very desk at school so that later on, in the real world outside the school, they do not commit the error of forgetting themselves. A man who forgets himself in front of a person who insults him identifies himself with that person, becomes fascinated, falls into the deep sleep of the conscience, hurts or kills and inevitably goes to prison. He who does not become fascinated with the person who insults him, and does not identify himself with that person, does not forget himself. He who knows how to pay conscious attention, would be incapable of giving any importance to the words of an insulter, or would be incapable of wounding or killing. All the errors that human beings commit in life are because they forget themselves, they identify, become fascinated and fall into sleep. It would be better for young people, for all students, to be taught how to awaken their conscience instead of being enslaved with so many absurd disciplines. Fundamental Education. Samael Aun Weor. 22. Chapter 5. What to think, how to think at home and at school. Parents and teachers always tell us what we should think, but never in life do they teach us how to think. To know what to think is relatively easy. Our parents, teachers, tutors, authors, etc., each of them is a dictator in his own way. Each of them wants us to think about their dictations, demands, theories, prejudices, etc. Dictators of the mind are as common as weeds. Everywhere there is a perverse tendency to enslave, to bottle up other people's minds, to force them to live within determined norms, prejudices, etc. Thousands of millions of dictators of the mind have never wanted to respect the mental freedom of anyone. If someone does not think like them, he is classified as perverse, renegade, ignorant and so on. Everybody wants to enslave everyone. Everybody wants to violate the intellectual freedom of other people. Nobody wants to respect other people's freedom of thought. Everyone feels sensible, wise, marvelous, and as it is natural, wants others to be like him, to make of him a hero, to think like him. The mind has been abused too much. Observe businessmen and their advertisements on newspapers, radio and television, etc. Commercial advertising is made in a dictatorial way. Buy such and such a soap. Such and such shoes. Buy it now. Immediately. Do not leave it for tomorrow. It has to be done immediately. Etc. The only thing left for them to say is that if you do not obey, you will be put in jail or killed. A parent forcefully wants to push his own ideas into his child and a schoolteacher reprimands, punishes and gives low grades, if a boy or girl does not dictatorially accept the teacher's ideas. Half of humanity wants to enslave the mind of the other half of humanity. This tendency to enslave other people's minds stands out at first sight, when we study the dark pages of black history. Everywhere there have existed and still exist bloody dictators determined to enslave countries, bloody dictatorships that dictate what people should think. Unfortunate is he who tries to think freely. He inevitably goes to a concentration camp, Siberia, prison, hard labor, he is hung, shot, exiled, etc. Neither teachers, nor parents nor books want to teach how to think. Fundamental education. Samael Aun Weor. 23 people enjoy forcing others to think in the way that they believe is right, and it is obvious that everyone is a dictator in his own way when it comes to the situation. Each of us thinks we have the last word, that everyone else should think in our way, because we are the best. Parents, teachers, and bosses scold their subordinates over and over again. That horrible tendency of humanity to be disrespectful to others, to violate other people's mind, to cage, lock up, enslave, and chain other people's minds is frightening. A husband wants to force into his wife's head his doctrine, ideas, etc., and a woman wants to do the same. Many times, husband and wife divorce because of incompatibility of ideas. Marriage partners do not want to understand the need to respect each other's intellectual freedom. No partner has the right to enslave the other partner's mind. Each of fact deserves respect. Each has the right to think as they like, to practice their religion, to belong to whatever political party they want to. School children are forced to think about certain ideas, but are not taught how to use their minds. Children's minds are tender, flexible and ductile, while those of elderly people are hard, fixed like concrete in a mold. They do not and cannot change. Children's and young people's minds are capable of many changes, and their minds can change. Children and young people can be taught how to think. It is difficult to teach elderly people how to think because they are the way they are and die in this way. In life, it is very rare to find an old person interested in changing radically. People's minds are shaped from childhood. That is what parents and school teachers prefer to do. They enjoy shaping the mind of children and young people. A mind and a goal is in fact a conditioned mind, an enslaved mind. It is necessary that school teachers break the fetters of the mind. It is imperative that teachers know how to guide the minds of children towards true freedom, so that they are not enslaved anymore. Fundamental Education. Samael Aun Weor. 24. It is indispensable that teachers teach their students how to think. Teachers should understand the need to teach students the path of analysis, meditation, understanding. No understandable person should ever accept anything in a dogmatic way. It is urgent to first investigate, understand, and inquire before accepting. In other words, we shall say that there is no need to accept, but instead, we should investigate, analyze, meditate and understand. When understanding is complete, acceptance is unnecessary. It is useless to fill our heads with intellectual information if on leaving school we do not know how to think and continue like living machines, repeating the same routine of our parents, grandparents and great-grandparents. To always repeat the same thing, to live the life of machines, from home to work, and from work to home, to marry and become little child-making machines, is not living. If that is what we study for, if that is why we go to school, college and university for 12 or 15 years, we would be better off by not studying. Mahatma Gandhi was a very unique man. Many times Protestant pastors sat on his doorstep for whole hours trying to convert him to Protestant Christianity. Gandhi did not accept the teaching of pastors, neither did he reject them. He understood and respected them, and that was all. Many times Mahatma said, "I am Brahmin, Jewish, Christian, Muslim, etc." Mahatma understood that all religions are necessary because they contain the same eternal values. Accepting or rejecting any doctrine or concept reveals a lack of mental maturity. When we reject or accept something, it is because we have not understood it. Whenever understanding exists, accepting or rejecting is unnecessary. The mind that believes, the mind that does not believe, and the mind that doubts is an ignorant mind. The path of wisdom does not lie in believing, not believing or doubting. The path of wisdom consists in inquiring, analyzing, meditating, experimenting. Truth is the unknown from moment to moment. truth has nothing to do with what one believes or stops believing, neither does it have anything to do with skepticism. Fundamental Education Samael Aun Weor 25 Truth is not a matter of accepting or rejecting, it is something to experience, live and understand. All the efforts on the part of teachers should, in the ultimate synthesis, take students into experiencing what is real, what is true. It is urgent that school teachers abandon old-fashioned and damaging tendencies, which are always directed at shaping the pliable and ductile minds of children. It is absurd for adults, filled with prejudices, passions, old-fashioned preconceptions, etc., to damage children's and young people's minds, in trying to shape their mind according to their rotten, dumb, old-fashioned ideas. It is better to respect the intellectual freedom of their students, respect their mental quickness, their creative spontaneity. Teachers do not have the right to confine the minds of students to a cage. What is essential is not to dictate to the minds of students what to think, but rather, to teach fully how to think. The mind is the instrument of knowledge, and it is necessary for teachers to teach their students how to use that instrument wisely. Fundamental Education Samael Aun Weor 26 Chapter 6 The Search for Security. When chicks are afraid, they hide under the loving wings of a hen in search for security. A frightened child runs to find his mother, because beside her he feels secure. This demonstrates that fear and the search for security are found intimately associated. A man that fears being assaulted by assailants finds security in a gun. A country that fears being attacked by another country buys cannons, planes, warships, it will arm armies and prepare for war. Many people who do not know how to work are terrified when faced with misery, they search for security in crime by becoming thieves or assailants. Many women who lack intelligence are frightened when faced with the possibility of misery and become prostitutes. A jealous man who fears losing his wife searches for security in his gun, he kills and afterwards ends in jail. A jealous woman kills her rival or her husband and, in this way, becomes a murderer. She fears losing her husband, and wanting to secure him, she kills another woman or resolves to kill him. A landlord fearful that people will not pay him the rent demands contracts, bonds, deposits, etc., wanting to insure himself. If all the landlords of a city do the same, a poor widow with children, who cannot fulfill those heavy requirements, will have to sleep on the street or in the city's parks with her children. All wars have their origin in fear. The Gestapo, torture, concentration camps, Siberias, horrible prisons, exiles, forced labor, firing squads, etc., have their origin in fear. Nations attack other nations because of fear. They search for security in violence, thinking that by killing, invading, etc., they can make themselves secure, strong and powerful. Fundamental Education Samael Aun Weor 27 In the secret police offices of counter-espionage, both East and West, spies are tortured, because the government fears for the state's security. All crimes, wars and transgressions, have their origin in fear and in the search for security. In bygone days there was sincerity among people. Today, fear and the search for security have done away with the wonderful fragrance of sincerity. Friends distrust friends. They fear that their friend will rob them, swindle or exploit them, and they even use in a stupid and perverse way, proverbs such as this one, never turn your back on your best friend. Hitler-like people used to say that this proverb was golden. Now a friend fears a friend and even uses proverbs to protect himself. There is no longer sincerity among friends. Fear and the search for security have done away with the delightful fragrance of sincerity. Castro ruse in Cuba has sent millions of citizens to the firing squad, fearful that these citizens would be the end of him. Castro seeks security in firing squads. He thinks that in this way he can find security. The perverse and bloodthirsty Stalin plagued Russia with his bloody purges. That was his way of finding security. Hitler organized the Gestapo, the frightening Gestapo, for the security of the state. There is no doubt that he feared that he would be overthrown, and because of this he founded the bloody Gestapo. Every bitterness of this world has its origins in the search for security and fear. School teachers should teach their students the virtue of courage. It is unfortunate that children are filled with fear in their own home. Children are threatened, intimidated, terrorized, and beaten. It is the custom of parents and teachers to terrorize children and teenagers with the purpose of forcing them to study. It is common to tell children and teenagers that if they do not study they will have to beg for money and they will wander the streets starving, or will work in humble jobs such as shoe shining, carrying bales, selling newspapers, etc., as if work was a crime. Deep down, behind all the words of parents and teachers, there exists fear for children and the search for security for children. Fundamental Education Samael Aun Weor 28. The serious thing about all of this is that the child or teenager develops complexes, he becomes fearful and later on in life, becomes a person filled with fear. Parents and teachers, who have the bad taste of frightening children and teenagers in an unconscious way, take them down a path of crime. As we have already said, every crime has its origins in fear and the search for security. Nowadays, fear and the search for security have turned the planet Earth into a horrible hell. The whole world fears and wants security. In bygone days one could travel freely, but now borders are filled with armed guards, passports and certificates of every type are demanded to be able to go from one country into another. All of this is the result of fear and the search for security. He who arrives is feared, and security is found in passports and papers of all types. School teachers, college and university lecturers should understand the horror of all this and cooperate for the good of the world, by knowing how to educate the new generations, and teaching them the path of real values. It is imperative to teach new generations not to fear and not to search for securities in anything or anyone. It is indispensable that every individual learns to be more confident in himself. Fear and the search for security are terrible weaknesses that transform life into a terrifying hell. Everywhere abound fearful cowards and weak people who are always in search for security. Life is feared, death is feared, other people's opinions, gossip is feared, the loss of a social or political position is feared, the loss of prestige, money, a lovely house, a beautiful woman, a good husband, a job, a business, a monopoly, the furniture, the car, etc., is feared. Everything is feared. Cowards, fearful people, weak people abound everywhere. However, nobody thinks himself a coward, everyone boasts of being strong, of being courageous, etc. In all social classes there exist thousands of millions of interests that one fears to lose, and because of this everyone looks for securities that become more and more complex, making life more difficult, complicated, bitter, cruel, and merciless. All gossip, slander, intrigues, etc., have their origins in fear and in the search for security. Fundamental Education Samael Aun Weor 29. To avoid losing our wealth, position, power and prestige, slander and gossip are propagated, murder is committed and people secretly pay for murders to be committed. Powerful people on earth even have the luxury of having salaried and well-paid murderers with a loathsome purpose of eliminating anyone who threatens to eclipse them. They love power for the sake of power and assure themselves of it on the basis of money and much blood. Newspapers are constantly reporting news of many suicide cases. Many believe that anyone who commits suicide is brave, but really anyone who commits suicide is a coward, who fears life and looks for security in the fleshless arms for death. Some war heroes were known as weak and cowardly people. When they saw themselves face to face with death, their terror was so frightening that they became terribly wild, searching for security for their life, and in making a supreme effort against death they were then declared heroes. Fear is often confused with courage. He who commits suicide seems to be very brave. He who carries a gun appears to be very brave, but in reality, people who commit suicide and carry guns are very coward. He who does not fear life will not commit suicide. He who does not fear anyone will not carry a gun on his waist. It is imperative that school teachers teach citizens in a clear and precise way what true courage is and what fear is. Fear and the search for security have turned the world into a dreadful hell. Fundamental Education Samael Aun Weor 30 Chapter 7 Ambition. Ambition has several causes and one of them is fear. A humble boy, who in the parks of capital cities cleans the shoes of proud gentlemen, could become a thief, if he begins to fear poverty, fear himself or his future. A humble machinist who works in an expensive store could become a thief or a prostitute overnight, if she begin to fear the future, life, old age or herself. An elegant waiter of a luxurious restaurant or a grand hotel could become a gangster, a bank robber or a very high-class thief, if by misfortune he begins to fear himself, his humble position as a waiter, or his own future. An insignificant insect covets being elegant. A poor shop assistant, who serves clients and who with patience shows us a tie, a shirt, shoes, making many bows with a plastic smile, covets something more because he is afraid, he fears misery, a somber future, old age, etc. Ambition is multifaceted. Ambition has the face of a saint and a devil, the face of a man and a woman, the face of concern and of indifference, of virtue and of a sinner. There exists ambition in he who wants to get married, and in that hardened old bachelor who detests marriage. There exists ambition in he who desires with infinite madness to be someone, to take part, to climb, and there exists ambition in he who becomes a hermit, in he who does not want anything of this world, because his only ambition is to reach heaven, to liberate himself, etc. There exists worldly ambition and spiritual ambition. Sometimes ambition uses the mask of indifference or sacrifice. Whoever does not covet this miserable wretched world, covets the other, and he who does not covet money, covets psychic powers. The ego, the id, the myself, delights in hiding ambition, putting it in the most secret nook of the mind and then says, I do not covet anything, I love my fellow men, I work unselfishly for the good of all human beings. The political old fox and he who knows it all, sometimes astonishes the masses with his apparent and selfish deeds, but when he abandons his job, it is hardly normal for him not to leave his country carrying out a few million pounds or dollars. Fundamental Education Samael Aun Weor 31 Ambition disguised with the mask of unselfishness often fools the most astute people. There exist in the world many people who only covet not being covetous. There are many people who renounce all pomp and vanity of this world, because they only covet their own intimate self-perfection. The penitent, that walks on his knees up to the temple and who, filled with faith, lashes himself, apparently does not covet anything, and even gives himself the luxury of giving without asking anything back from anyone. However, it is clear that he covets a miracle, a cure, health for himself or for some relative, or indeed, covets eternal salvation. We admire truly religious men and women, but we lament that they do not love their religion with true unselfishness. The holy religions, the sublime sects, orders, spiritual societies, etc., deserve our unselfish love. It is very rare to find in this world someone who loves his religion, school, sect, etc., unselfishly. This is unfortunate. The whole world is filled with ambitions. Hitler hurled himself into war because of ambition. All wars have their origins in fear and ambition, and the most serious problems of life have their origins in ambition. The whole world lives fighting the whole world due to ambition. Some against others and everyone against everyone else. Every person in life covets being someone, and people of a certain age, teachers, parents, tutors, etc., motivate children and teenagers to continue down the horrendous path of ambition. Elders tell students, you have to be someone in life, become rich, get married to a millionaire, be powerful, etc. The old, horrible, ugly, old-fashioned generation wants new generations also to be ambitious, ugly and horrible like them. The gravity of this is that new generations let themselves be talked into and led down the horrible path of ambition. Fundamental Education Samael Aun Weor 32 School teachers should teach students that no honest job deserves contempt. It is absurd to look disdainfully at a driver, a shop assistant, a peasant, a shoe shiner, etc. Every humble job is beautiful and necessary in social life. Not all of us were born to be engineers, governors, presidents, doctors, lawyers, etc. In society, all jobs and trades are needed. No honest job can ever be distasteful. In everyday life, each human being serves a purpose, and the important thing is to know what purpose one serves. It is the duty of teachers to discover the vocation of each student and guide him or her in the direction. He who works in life in accordance with his vocation will work with true love and without ambition. Love should replace ambition. Vocation is that which we really like, that profession, which we happily fulfill because it is what pleases us and what we love to do. Unfortunately, in modern life people work unwillingly because of ambition, since they perform jobs that do not coincide with their vocation. When someone works at something that he likes, with true vocation, he does it with love, because he loves his vocation, and because his abilities in life are precisely those of his vocation. It is precisely the task of teachers to know how to guide students to discover their abilities and to orientate them along the path of a real vocation. Fundamental Education, Samael Aun Weor, 33, Chapter 8, Love. Starting from school desks, students should understand fully that which is called love. Fear and dependency are often confused with love, however they are not. Students depend on their parents and teachers, and it is clear that they respect and fear them at the same time. Children and teenagers depend on their parents for clothing, food, money, shelter, etc., and clearly they always feel protected. They know they depend on their parents, and for this reason respect and even fear them, but this is not love. As proof of what we are saying, we can verify exactly that any child or teenager trusts more his school friends than his own parents. Really and truly, these children and teenagers talk with their school friends about intimate things that they would never discuss with their own parents. This is showing us that there is no real trust between children and their parents, that there is no true love. It is urgent to understand that there is a radical difference between love and that which is fear, respect, dependency. It is urgent to give due respect to our parents and teachers, but not to confuse this respect with love. Respect and love should be intimately joined, but we should not confuse one with the other. Parents fear for their children and want the best for them, a good job, a wonderful marriage, security, etc., and confuse this fear with true love. It is necessary to understand that without true love it is impossible for parents and teachers to guide new generations wisely, even though they might have good intentions. The path that leads to the abyss is paved with good intentions. Let us look at the case known worldwide as Rebel Without a Cause. This is a mental epidemic that has spread throughout the world. Hundreds of rich kids, said to be spoilt, cherished and loved by their parents, who attack defenseless pedestrians, beat and rape women, steal, stone, hang around in gangs, causing Fundamental Education, Samael Aun Weor, 34, damage to everything. They are disrespectful to teachers, parents, etc. The rebels without a cause are the result of lack of true love. Where there exists true love, there cannot exist rebels without a cause. If parents really loved their children, they would know how to guide them intelligently, and there would be no rebels without a cause. Rebels without a cause are the result of bad guidance. Parents have not felt enough love for them to really dedicate themselves to guiding their children wisely. Modern parents only think of money and of giving their children more and more, the latest car, the latest fashion and clothes, etc., but they do not really love. Parents do not truly love, they do not know how to love, and the result is the rebels without a cause. The superficiality of this era is due to a lack of true love. Modern life is like a shallow pond, no depth to it. In the profound lake of life many creatures can exist, a lot of fish, but a puddle by the side of the road is soon dried up by the rays of the sun, and then the only thing left behind is mud, poverty and ugliness. It is impossible to understand the beauty of life in all its glory if we have not learnt to love. People confuse respect and fear with love. We respect our superiors, fear them, and then we think we love them. Children fear their parents and teachers, respect them, and then think they love them. The child fears the whiplash, authority, bad grad,